Blackstone Publishing presents Third Thoughts by Steven Weinberg. This book is read by John Lescault. Preface. This is the third collection of my essays for general readers published by Harvard University Press. Some of these essays are polemics on subjects such as the harm done by inequality, the folly of programs of manned spaceflight, the wrong-headedness of some fashions in writing history, the danger of global warming, and the importance of support for public goods, including basic science. As before, they present a point of view that is rationalist, realist, reductionist, and devoutly secular. Other essays aim at explaining aspects of modern physics and cosmology and their past in non-technical terms. In some cases, footnotes have been added to clarify things that may have been obscure in the essays as originally published. I fear that the reader will find some scientific topics repeated from one essay to another, including broken symmetry, weak and strong nuclear forces, the early universe, and the multiverse. It can't be helped. These days, these topics are much on the minds of many physicists. As in the earlier collections, Facing Up and Lake Views, most of these essays were published in the New York Review of Books, in newspapers, and in other periodicals. Essays 20, 23, and 25 are brief talks given at university graduations and have not been previously published. Essay 24 has not been published until now because everyone who read it disagreed with it. But I am fond of it, and so bring it out here. In this volume, I have departed from my practice in earlier essay collections, in which I arranged all essays together in chronological order. I have here instead sorted these essays out into four broad categories and arranged them in chronological order only within each category. But these categories should not be taken too seriously. In discussing historical matters in Part 1, I have had to explain aspects of physics and astronomy. And I have not been able to discuss physics and astronomy in Part 2 without giving some account of their history. Both science and its history are also included here and there in Parts 3 and 4 on public and personal matters. I owe a great debt to editors who have helped to bring these essays to the reading public. In particular, thanks are due to Michael Fisher, who first suggested that Harvard University Press bring out a collection of my essays, to Jeff Dean for good advice, and for seeing the current collection through to publication, and to the late Robert Silvers, who worked with unending skill and patience to improve my articles in the New York Review of Books. I take this opportunity to give special thanks to Louise Weinberg. Taking time from her own writing on law, she read the early drafts of many of these articles, provided the titles for many of them, and for Facing Up and To Explain the World, suggested the Grimshaw painting for the jacket of this volume, and gave valuable advice about rearranging material. Many obscurities and puerilities were avoided through her help. From past experience, it seems that at my rate of writing, it takes about a decade to produce enough new essays for assembly in a collection. I hope, nevertheless, that this will not be my last collection. But given actuarial realities, perhaps this would be a good time for me to add a word of thanks to readers who, over many years, have put up with my polemics and explanations, and have thereby given me a precious contact with the world beyond physics. 1. Science History. 1. The Uses of Astronomy. This essay had its start in a lecture I gave on the deck of the bark Sea Cloud while cruising the Aegean Sea. The passengers were mostly friends from Austin, visiting sites of the ancient world. In the spirit of the voyage, I volunteered to give an evening talk on a subject that had lately fascinated me, Greek astronomy. A few years later, I recycled this lecture in a talk at the Harry Ransom Center in Austin. The HRC has a superb collection of materials related to literature and other arts, but it is not concentrated much on science. Nevertheless, in September 2009, it was able to put on a grand show, Other Worlds, Rare Astronomical Works, including early editions of Copernicus and Galileo. As an enthusiastic amateur in the history of science, I was glad to be asked to give an evening talk to help celebrate this exhibition. I was also glad to have this chance to take a swipe at a bête noire, NASA's wasteful program of manned spaceflight. I then sent a written version of my HRC talk to Robert Silvers at the New York Review of Books. It was published the following month on October 22, 2009, illustrated with a copy of one of the HRC exhibits, the frontispiece of Galileo's Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief Systems of the World, showing figures representing Aristotle, Ptolemy, and Copernicus. This is pretty much the essay that appears below, with only a few corrections. Later, it also served as the basis of Chapter 6 of my book, To Explain the World. A few years ago, I decided that I needed to know more about the history of science. So, naturally, I volunteered to teach the subject. In working up my lectures, I was struck with the fact that in the ancient world, astronomy reached what, from a modern perspective, was a much higher level of accuracy and sophistication than any other natural science. One obvious reason for this is that visible astronomical phenomena are much simpler and easier to study than the things we can observe on the Earth's surface. The ancients did not know it, but the Earth and Moon and planets all spin at nearly constant rates, and they travel in their orbits under the influence of a single dominant force, that of gravitation. In consequence, the changes in what is seen in the sky are simple and periodic. The moon regularly waxes and wanes. The sun and moon and stars seem to revolve once a day around the celestial pole, and the sun traces a path through the same constellations of stars every year, those of the zodiac. Of course, the stars are not visible during the day, but some of them can be seen just after sunset, when the sun's position in the sky is still known. Even with crude instruments, these periodic changes could be, and were, studied with a fair degree of mathematical precision, much greater than was possible for things on Earth, like the flight of a bird or the flow of water in a river. But there was another reason why astronomy was so prominent in ancient and medieval science. It was useful, in a way that the physics and biology of the time were not. Even before history began, people must have used the apparent motion of the sun as at least a crude clock, calendar, and compass. These functions became much more precise with the introduction of what may have been the first scientific instrument, the gnomon, attributed by the Greeks variously to Anaximander or to the Babylonians. The gnomon is simply a straight pole, set vertically in a flat, horizontal patch of ground open to the sun's rays. When during each day the gnomon's shadow is shortest, that is noon. At noon, the gnomon's shadow anywhere in the latitude of Greece or Mesopotamia points due north. So all the points of the compass can be permanently and accurately marked out on the ground around the gnomon. Watching the shadow at noon from day to day, one can note the days when the noon shadow is shortest or longest. That is the summer or the winter solstice. From the length of the noon shadow at the summer solstice, one can calculate the latitude. The shadow at sunset points somewhat south of east in the spring and summer, and somewhat north of east in the fall and winter. When the shadow at sunset points due east, that is the spring or fall equinox.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.